So welcome to this program, Into the Shepherds of the King. And for the last two or three programs, we are going to go in the Word of God and be able to look at some of the things that and some of the promises that God has actually given to us. You know, in the Bible, when Jesus was leaving, he said that he came to establish the kingdom. And so, and then it says in the book of Matthew 6:33 that we are supposed to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all the other things shall be added unto us. And the same thing book in Matthew, it goes on to compare us, and it says that if God is able to provide for the birds of the air and also for the grass that is here today and it's gone tomorrow, how much more shall he provide for you? And so what I'm calling this is where we call it the course correction, to be able to see surely in all areas, all aspects of life, have we aligned our belief system with what the Word says? Because most of the time I tell you, if the Word says something contrary to your belief system, you don't change the Word, you change your belief system. So the first part, like today, we're going to go ahead and look at some of the promises that God has given to us. When Jesus said it was finished on the cross, what actually did he mean by that? What are some of the things? I know we can't be able to cover all of them, but what are some of the things that Jesus actually, when he said it is finished, he was able to take them and give them to us? So we start in the book of Genesis. In the book of Genesis, we see that God, once he created man, he gave man dominion. But when we see in the book of Matthew 4, when Satan is tempting Jesus, he tells him, he takes him to this high place and he shows him the kingdom of the world and their glory. And he says to Jesus that if Jesus worships Satan, then Satan would give him the kingdom of the earth and their glory. So when did that change hands? Because when God created man, that kingdom of the earth and their glory he had given to man. We realize that most of the time when things change hands, it is not something that actually you can go back and pinpoint, like it was like maybe a discussion that happened. No, it is because we are in this kingdom and we are either advancing the kingdom of the enemy or the kingdom of God. And so by our actions, we are either giving dominion to God or operating from the dominion and the rules and the reins and the rules and the principles of God, or actually giving that dominion, the authority, the rule to the enemy by our actions. And so that's what we see in the book of Genesis. Satan never told Eve that once she eats from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that actually there will be anything else. All he told Eve is that she would be able to be like God, but he never told her what she would actually lose, what they would actually lose. And so when they were, Eve was deceived, Adam ate willingly, but there was a transference of dominion or authority that God had given Adam. And so most of the time, that transference of dominion, of authority from the body of Christ to the enemy happens when we participate in something that is not of the kingdom of God. In a place where we are doing actions that are not in line with God. And so that's what we see, because Adam and Eve sins, the dominion transferred. Otherwise, the temptation of Jesus would not have been any temptation. And so that's the whole thing. Then we come to the book of Matthew 28, right there from verse 17. And Jesus, he says that when once he's talking to his disciples, these are actually some of his last words. He tells them that all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to him. And so that means that it reminds me of Abraham. And when Abraham told Lot to choose what side of the land he would want, and whatever side he chooses, then Abraham would go in the opposite direction. But when God came to Abraham, he said, look to the east, to the west, to the north, to the south, and all this land I have given you. So that is the same thing. And so when Jesus resurrected, we are looking at some of the things that he actually was able to accomplish. And so when Jesus resurrected, one of the things that he was able to get for us back was the authority that Adam had given out and the dominion that he had given out when he sinned. And so, but just because we have that authority and we get it, because it's with Jesus, but because we are one with him, we operate. You know, I took some time last week to teach on what does it mean to be joint heirs. And to understand joint heirs with Jesus, as it says in the book of Galatians 3 and also Galatians 4, right there at the beginning, and also Romans 8:15, and right there. So it says that we are heirs of God and we are joint heirs with Jesus Christ. And so being a joint heir, to understand that, is to look at something like a joint bank account. You know, in a joint bank account, the two people that have, or maybe two or three that have opened the account, they put their money together. And so when they put their money together, each of them can withdraw their money and use the money, but the other one will be aware of what the other one is doing. And so that's what joint heir means, that whatever Jesus has, he has put it together. And so we are able to withdraw out of his achievement and be able, that's where we become, you know, he gives us almost his name, like the power of the attorney. So that's where he gives us his name, so that we can use his name to withdraw some of the things that he was able to accomplish on the cross. And so one of the things that he put in there is that authority, because he says all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to him. And so from there, any believer can be able to go and get authority, you know, and authority to be able to get that authority to be able to do things. And I don't think I have taken time to explain the difference between authority and power. Because most of the time when you look at the Bible, it kind of intermixes the two. So authority is the legal right to do something. The power is just the power to do that thing. So think of it as a policeman having a gun. That gun is power. And then he can have a gun, but he doesn't have authority to use it. So, you know, like most policemen, they have jurisdiction. And so they have a county in which they can operate. And so if he goes to another county, even if he's licensed to carry his gun, he can't use that gun in that county because he doesn't have authority to use it there. So think of it like that. Authority is the legal right to do something, and then there's the power to do that, and we get the power from Holy Spirit. And so Jesus now is giving us all authority, but that authority is usually, some of it is because of what it is that God called you to do. Some of it is and so there's some of it is because of the governmental anointing that you carry. So there's all these different authority that you have, that some of it is specialized authority. And so you need to know what authority God has given you and also what authority that you can pursue and be able to get, because whoever overcomes, they occupy. And so if you keep overcoming, then you occupy. But then if you go and you have that authority and then you use the authority to do things that are not in line with God, then you open the door for the enemy to take the same authority that God has given you. And so we see that with Adam and Eve. So let's go now and look at maybe two or three things, maybe three, that God has actually promised us in his word. So the first thing that I want us to look at is the blessing. Because with the blessing, it says that in the book of Galatians 3:13, that is a scripture. We read that, and sometimes we just read it concerning the curses and not really read it concerning the blessing that God has given us. And so it says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on the tree, that the blessings of Abraham might come unto the Gentile through Christ Jesus, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. And so I want us to stop there, because most of the time I keep telling you, if you come to so many Christians and you have two doors, and one door is written blessing and the other one is written miracles, and you tell Christians to walk through whichever door they think is powerful, most of them will walk through the door of the miracles. But you have to remember that for a miracle to happen, there has to be a crisis. And the best way to explain a blessing is, because a blessing is not something tangible, it's something that is spiritual that God gives you. It's just like things like favor, where God gives you favor, where God gives you grace. They are not tangible, but when you have favor, it manifests, because other people do things that are favorable to you, and so that means it sometimes manifests in the physical. And so think of it like that. Like, when you would you rather be sick and then you want a miracle of healing, or would you rather walk in the blessing of healing, so that you walk in divine health, that you've never been sick? Would you rather not have any money and then you confess and then you get a car, maybe confess for 6 months, somebody buys you a car? That's a miracle. But the blessing is when you are so blessed that when you need the car, you know, you are able to generate resources. When you need a car, you just go buy the car. And so you don't have to confess it. You have enough money to just go do that. So the blessing of God is mostly better. Miracles are needed, yes, because sometimes there's crisis, there's sicknesses. We live in a foreign world. And so we need miracles. But remember, for miracles to happen, there needs to be crisis. And so I feel like one of the areas that we as the body of Christ have not meditated on is on a fast gratitude on the blessings that God has given us. So what has God blessed you to be? Remember, he created you for good works, which he prepared beforehand that you should walk in them. And we see that also with Jeremiah, where he says, before you were in your mother's womb, I ordained you to be a prophet to the nations. And so, because God is not a respecter of persons, so that means that before you were in your mother's womb, God ordained you to do something on the face of the earth. I'm telling you, if you find out what that is and start moving in it, sometimes I like to call that a birthright. And so the way to understand a birthright is being able to look at the children of Israel. And we are going to look at all these things that God has given us in the light of the children of Israel, but we'll do it during the next episode. And so We look at the blessings of Abraham. What were the blessings of Abraham? And so there's so many. You know, last time we listed a few from Deuteronomy 1 through 7. But you can read Deuteronomy 1 through 14 and be able to see the blessings. But you can read the rest from 15 to 65 or to the very end, 64, 65, and see the curses of disobedience, because now that's what Christ has redeemed you from. And so because he has redeemed you from all those curses, so that means that whatever is stated there, you're supposed to walk in opposite of it. Remember, a blessing is an empowerment. And I think one example that I gave you that is very clear is Joseph. Joseph was blessed to be a leader. So that's the blessing that God placed upon him. And so whether he was in the palace, whether he was in his father's household, whether he was in prison, and wherever he was, whether he was in Potiphar's house, he was a leader, because the blessing of leadership was upon him. And it did not matter the circumstances where he was placed, the blessings were able to flow. And so that's what the blessing is. And so now I want you to take time and be able to look at the different blessings that God gave, promised the people of Israel. Because right here, the Bible is making it clear that those blessings that he had spoken over them, you know, just simple, some of the blessings, like Abraham, God will make Abraham to be a nation, a big nation. And, you know, that's a blessing. And you can stand with that and trust that Christ has redeemed you from the curse of the law and made that blessing to be able to flow into you. And so there is that with the blessings of God. And so take time and understand, because if you don't understand that, then you are not able to walk in the kingdom of God with fulfillment, because you're always looking for miracles instead of being grateful for the blessings that he has given you. And so one of the examples that I give you, maybe that's a manifestation of a blessing, could be your job. Some people are not grateful and they don't even testify about the job that God has given them. And so if you see your job as a blessing, then you can be able to nurture that, be able to get a raise and keep moving. And so that means that you're able to provide for yourself consistently without needing a miracle. So that is one area. When Jesus said it is finished, that means that he removed the curse of the law and then he released the blessing. The other thing that he did, so we can also look at the curses, because that is another thing that he actually removed. The Bible says a causeless curse cannot alight. And so most of the people believe, we see that the curses will be there even in the book of Revelation. But when you're in Christ, then you can be able to stand by that a causeless curse is not going to alight in you, because Christ has redeemed you. And also you are supposed to go to the Word. If that curse that is coming upon you, you can be able to see it in the Word of God in the Old Testament, then you are able to say, no, Christ has redeemed me from this, then I'm supposed to walk in the blessing. It says in the book of Numbers 23:23, there is no sorcery against Jacob, no divination against Israel. It now must be said of Jacob and of Israel, oh, what God has done. And so there is no sorcery, there is no divination. Where there is Jacob, put your name on there. Where there is Israel, put your family's name there. And you stand on that and you say, no, there is no divination against us. There is no sorcery against us, because Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. And then the one I was telling you is in the book of Proverbs 26:2. Proverbs 26:2 says, like a fretting sparrow, like a flying swallow, so these are birds, so a curse without cost shall not alight. And so you have to remember that a curse that costless shall not alight. And so you just trust God in that if a curse is sent towards you, most of the people spend more time meditating on the kingdom of darkness than they meditate on the kingdom of light. I keep giving you this example. When my sister used to work in the bank, and they used to count money by hand, and for months they would be given the currency, the true currency, the real currency, and they would, their hands would get used to the real, and one day they would slip a fake currency, and their hands would be able to detect the fake currency because they are used to the real. And so that's what I would encourage you as a Christian. Do you understand who God is? Do you know him? How do you know him? What is your relationship? Not what, you know, the cliche of Sunday morning, but when you are by yourself, how is it that you relate to God? And then from there, when you understand your relationship, how are you, do you know the Godhead? Do you have a relationship with God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit? What are the angels that he has given you, or he has given assignment to? Do you understand the assignment? And so, and then what is the power in the word? Because he has exalted his word above his name. What is it that you actually believe in his word? And so once you start meditating on the righteous things that he has said, then you're actually able to detect the fake. And so spend time meditating on righteousness, spend time meditating on the blessings. I keep reminding you that so many of you can be able to tell me the generational curses in your bloodline. And but when I ask you of the generational blessings, you have no clue of generational blessings. And so I want you to go to your family and see what are some of the generational blessings. And if you can't be able to pinpoint some, remember you have been born from above. That is if you know God. And if you know God, you have been born from above. And so that means that even when you take communion, that means what you are saying is he has pulled his resources, his blood has become your blood, his body has become your body, his being has become your being has become his, and so you're one with him. And so that means that whatever he has achieved and accomplished, you can be able to say, this is what I too have accomplished, and you can be able to build from that foundation. And so meditate on that, meditate on the blessings that are coming from Jesus, because you get to partake. That's your bloodline too. And so it does not matter if you didn't have a good bloodline, a good childhood, because in the bloodline of Jesus, that is perfect, that is great. And so the other thing that God has given to us, I know we won't be able to go into depth with this, but the same way that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, he has redeemed us from sickness and disease, poverty and death. And so we are going to look at sickness and disease. And we are going to go into a little bit of detail on that during the next time. But today I want us to look at that in the book of 1 Peter 2:24. In the book of 1 Peter 2:24, it says that Jesus, when he was being beaten, when he was being beat with those stripes that came on his back, by those stripes we were healed. And so if, you know, the Bible is bold to say, as Jesus is, so are we in this world. And so I want you to stop and think, is Jesus sick? You know, if Jesus is not sick right now and he's saying as he is, so are you in this world. And I knew the Bible, the Bible, because they knew if they don't light in this world, we'll be able to interpret that to mean anything else other than in this world. And so I feel like that's why it was added on there, as he is, so are we in this world. And so he's not sick, we are not sick. He's not struggling, we are not struggling. Whatever is going, and that's why the Lord, when he was teaching on the Lord's Prayer, he said, let your will be done on the earth as it is in heaven. Because he knew that all in heaven, things are being done in one. And so right now, ask yourself, what is being done in heaven? In heaven, there's peace. In heaven, there's joy unspeakable. In heaven, there's, you know, worshiping God and praising God. There's no fear. There's no worry. And so when he says your will, God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven, we need to meditate on what is being done in heaven. You know, the Bible goes ahead to tell us that we are supposed to keep our mind or our eyes on things that are not, because the thing on things that are not, because the things that are were made by the things that are not. And also it goes on to say, keep your mind on things above, but not things beneath. And so if you're keeping your mind on things above, that means that that saying, you know, there's one saying where people say they are so heavenly minded, they are no other good. You know, that's a lie. The more heavenly minded you are, the more other good you become, because that's what the scripture says. You keep your mind on things above. So you're keeping your mind on what is going on in heaven. And like what I'm telling you, if you keep your mind always meditating on evil and the demons and what they do and trying to understand them, or you're not keeping your mind on things above. And as a man thinketh in his heart, so he is. Whatever you meditate on, it starts to manifest. And so don't meditate, spend so much time meditating on something that you don't want for it to manifest. Spend time meditating on the goodness of God. Spend time meditating on the promises of God. Spend time meditating on the peace of God, on the humility of God, on the kindness of God. And then as you meditate on that, because he said the gospel of the kingdom is what it is that we are supposed to be preaching. And so what is the gospel of the kingdom? It is to understand how his kingdom operates, how his kingdom functions. And then when we understand how it functions, we come and replicate it here on the earth. And so we know that we can't replicate what is going on here on the earth without faith. And so we have to do everything by faith, because that which is not faith is sin. And so now I want to go back to you and I want to encourage you. One way to understand how his kingdom operates is to go back and meditate on the word. You know, the scripture compares two things. There's a time when Paul and Peter and John, they were with Jesus at the Mount of Transfiguration. And Jesus was transfigured, and Moses and Elijah came and started talking to Jesus. And the Bible says that we have a more sure word of prophecy than that encounter. You know, even when Jesus was tempted by Satan, he was being tempted. The moments before where Jesus was being tempted by Satan, we don't know how long it was, because he was fasting for 40 days. But we see that before he was taken by the Spirit to be tempted of the devil, there was that moment in him where he had this voice coming from heaven and saying, "This is my beloved son." And so he had already heard that voice from heaven. And we could have expected that when Satan is saying, "If you are the Son of God," that's it. Jesus would have said, "Yes, I'm the Son of God. Actually, the voice came and spoke to me." Jesus did not stand against the enemy with the voice that he had heard. He stood against the enemy with the word that was written, that is written. And so many of us say we are Christians, but you know, there's like 1186 or 89 chapters in the Bible. And so how many of those verses have you memorized? Not just memorizing, how many of them have you spent time in, like really meditating in, until they become, the Bible says, until day dawns inside of you? So we will say today that the blessings of Abraham has come upon you. But how many times have you really taken that and meditated on it until it has become a reality? And the way to do that is to take the word of God and you spend time with it until that revelation in the word becomes real in your heart. Because as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. God bless you, and we'll continue from here next time.